Welcome to today's coffee lecture, where I will explain to you in just 10 minutes what the new open access policy of the Swiss National Science Foundation requires and how you can comply with these requirements in practice, especially when publishing in non-open access journals using the so-called rights retention strategy. My name is Barbara Hirschmann, and I'm the head of the e-publishing office at ETH Library. During this lecture, we will first look at what the new requirements from the SNSF are and which options exist for ETH authors to put them into practice. Then we will focus on the topic of self-archiving articles in repositories and how the SNSF recommends to circumvent the problem of publisher-imposed embargoes by using the so-called rights retention strategy. Lastly, we will have a look at how publishers have reacted to this new strategy by research funders and what this means for authors. The new open access regulations apply to all SNSF-funded projects that have been submitted from January 2023 onwards. The most important changes compared to the previous rules are that all peer-reviewed articles must be published open access immediately, so without an embargo, and all articles must be published under a Creative Commons Attribution, short CC BY license. In principle, depending on the journal you publish in, there are three options how to implement these requirements in practice. The first option applies if you publish in a pure gold open access journal. In this case, you simply have to make sure that you select the correct license when submitting your article with the publisher, and then direct the APC invoice to the SNSF for payment through their Chronosub platform. The second option applies if you publish in a hybrid journal, meaning a subscription journal with an open access option, which is included in one of the open access funding agreements of ETH Library. In this case, make sure you select the correct license and go through the workflow at the publisher who recognizes you as an ETH member and directs the APC or invoice to ETH Library. The third option, self-archiving, comes into play if there is no option for funding an APC through either the SNSF or ETH Library. In this case, you can still try to ensure that your article will be open access immediately without any costs by using the so-called rights retention strategy and posting the paper on a repository, such as the research collection with CC BY license. This option is what I will explain in more detail on the next slides. When you publish in a subscription journal, it will happen quite often that you run into a problem with conflicting policies when it comes to open access self-archiving. Now, what does this mean? The SNSF requirement is that your articles are made open access immediately with a CC BY license. However, most scientific publishers have self-archiving policies that require embargoes. Usually, you're only allowed to release a self-archive accepted version of your article after a certain period of time, and also often only without a license or with a more restrictive license than what the SNSF requires. For example, let's look at the self-archiving policy of Current Biology. This CellPress journal requires an embargo of 12 months on the accepted version, and the publisher only allows it to be released under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial No Derivatives license. How can you comply with the SNSF open access requirement if the publisher has such a restrictive open access policy for self-archiving? The SNSF recommends that in these cases, you follow a strategy that was developed by an international coalition of research funders called Coalition S, which the SNSF has also joined. The main idea behind the strategy is the following. All researchers in third-party funded projects have signed a grant agreement. In the case of the SNSF and the other Coalition S research funders, this grant agreement always contains a clause that requires grant recipients to make their articles open access without embargo and to apply a CC BY license to their accepted manuscripts. Legally, this is interpreted as a so-called prior obligation, meaning that the obligation of authors to fulfill the requirements from the grant agreement with their funder takes legal precedence over any later agreement that a publisher may ask authors to sign. Therefore, the coalition as research funders take the position that even if a publishing contract says otherwise, funded authors still have the right and actually an obligation to comply with the requirements from the grant agreement. In order to put this obligation into practice, or let's say take advantage of this right, you can follow the procedure outlined on the SNSF website. First, it is important to note that you need to take action when submitting your article. It is not possible to apply the rights retention strategy later on if you have forgotten to do it during the submission. This is because the strategy asks you to insert a standard statement in the acknowledgement section of your article. The statement serves as a message to your publisher to let them know that you are funded by a grant which requires you to apply a CC BY license to your accepted manuscript. The standard statement for this is available from the SNSF website and can be copied and pasted into your article. You simply need to add your grant number to it. Once the publisher has accepted your article and the accepted version becomes available, you can already post it to a repository without an embargo. Of course, at ETH Library, we have also discussed this strategy with ETH Legal Services. And as a result from these discussions, we would like to give you some additional advice to keep in mind when working with the rights retention strategy. The first thing is, it is very important for this strategy to become legally valid that you inform the publisher about the rights retention. In principle, this can be done by only including the standard statement directly in the article. However, we recommend that you additionally enter the statement into the submission system of the publisher, for example, in a field for funder information, grant information, acknowledgements, or a comment field. Our second recommendation is that you document what exactly you have done to inform the publisher. This means that you should save the submitted version that contains the statement on your local device and also make a screenshot of the step in the submission process where you have entered the rights retention statement. Now, how do the publishers deal with this strategy in practice? In 2020, Coalition S, this coalition of research funders, has written a letter to over 150 publishers informing them of the new funder requirements of the research funders that have joined the coalition. Since then, publishers have reacted to this development with quite different approaches. There are some publishers that have adjusted their standard publishing agreements to allow all or at least the Coalition S funded authors to deposit their accepted manuscript to a repository without an embargo and make it available under a CC BY license. Examples for this approach are the publishers Microbiology Society or the Royal Society. In these cases, it is very simple for authors to use the rights retention strategy because the publishers have already agreed to accept this as part of their standard policies. Anecdotally, we also know that there have at least been some cases where publishers have refused to accept articles for publication that contain rights retention statements. The screenshot here is from a blog post from Cambridge University that has worked with rights retention for some time and that mentions two such cases that have been brought to their attention. Then there are publishers like Springer Nature, who states that they will accept articles with rights retention statements, but they require authors to confirm that the publisher's terms supersede any agreements the author might have made with a funder. This is an interesting approach because this statement is in direct conflict with the coalition S's own legal assessment and also actually with the assessment from ETH Legal Services. So currently at ETH Library, we basically assume that what Springer Nature states here is probably not legally valid and rather mostly serves the purpose of confusing authors and deterring them from using the rights retention strategy. Lastly, I want to mention the case of the American Chemical Society. ACS was one of those publishers that immediately went into strong opposition against the rights retention strategy when the coalition S first came up with it. Interestingly, however, just very recently, they have obviously decided to now see Coalition S funded authors as a new business opportunity. They invented something called article development charge, which is a charge of $2,500, which authors are asked to pay if they want to get the right to publish their accepted manuscript with a CC BY license on a repository. It's basically a fee for self-archiving, something that we have not seen before from any other publishers, and frankly, which we find a rather disturbing approach. So what to make from all of this? To be very honest, we also don't really know yet. Even if there are various tools out there for checking compliance of journals with the SNSF requirements, we think that we need to collect some real-life experiences from ETH authors in order to better understand all the challenges they encounter when putting this strategy into practice, especially with publishers that officially don't support it. Therefore, I would like to end this lecture with a call to action. Please contact us at the e-publishing office and tell us about any experiences you made with publishers when you submitted SNSF-funded articles with rights retention statements to them. We will try to collect these experiences and maybe they can help us to give guidance to other ETH authors in the future. We also think that it is really important that you report your feedback not only to us, but also to the SNSF, so they understand which problems this strategy might cause for authors. So thanks a lot for your attention, and I'm now happy to take any questions that you have.